During March month every year, the Tibetans commemorate anniversary of the Tibetan National Uprising when Tibetans took to the streets of Lhasa, Tibet's capital, to protest China's illegal invasion and occupation of their homeland. Despite ongoing pandemic and lockdown, Tibetans in Toronto recognized this day through virtual events and a car caravan protest last week. The virtual event included words of support across party lines from NDP MPP Butila Karpoche, Liberal MP R. Virani, City Councillor Gord Perks, the Honorable Nagu Tham He, and the Honorable Consiglio Di Nino. They also had Gloria Feng from Canada, Hong Kong Ling, Sheng Ji from the Federation of the Democratic China, and Zumritere Arkin from World Uyghur Congress in solidarity with the Tibetan movement. There were two panel discussions in Tibetan and English titled Tibetan National Uprising Day, 62nd years of struggles, challenges, and the way forward, with prominent Tibetan and allied activists as well as former elected officials of the Central Tibetan Administration. They also arranged a car rally protest in Chinatown, Toronto, which were organized by coalition includes Canadian Tibetan Association of Ontario, Students for a Free Tibet Canada, Tibetan Women's Association of Ontario, Canada Dokham, Chushi, Gangrok, and Regional Tibetan Youth Congress. I'm joined with Yudun Samsung from Students for a Free Tibet Canada. Welcome, Yudun. We really appreciate for your time. First of all, we would like to know, tell our viewers about the Tibetan National Uprising Day.
Of course. Thank you so much for having me to here. I really appreciate it. So Tibetan National Uprising Day is March 10th, 1959. That was when the Chinese government, you know, and the Chinese military were in Lhasa, which is the capital city of Tibet. Tens of thousands of Tibetans rose up. They surrounded the Potala Palace, which is the home of the Dalai Lama, and they wanted to protect him and also fight against the occupation of Tibet. There was open fire from the Chinese military. Tens of thousands of Tibetans lost their lives. And, you know, what ensued was the Dalai Lama, who was very young at the time, having to escape Tibet and having to, you know, escape to India. And after that, hundreds of thousands of Tibetans followed him. And, you know, India became a home away from home for many Tibetans following March 10, 1959. Since then, we commemorate it every single year, and it happens globally with Tibetans and supporters around the world.
So recently, Tibetan Canadians commemorated 62nd anniversary of the Tibetan National Uprising Day and called upon action from the Canadian government. What sort of action you anticipate from Canadian government?
Yes. So, every single time that we have any kinds of protests, we try to engage our Canadian government. We want them to, you know, be on the forefront, be the leaders in multilateral action to call on, you know, the Chinese government to stop its oppression of Tibetans and to give us human rights inside Tibet. With March 10th, we were able to get statements from, you know, Aaron O'Toole, who's the conservative leader, as well as Jagmeet Singh, who's the NDP leader. They, you know, wrote statements to recognize the Tibetan National Uprising Day and in support of our movement. So those are some kinds of actions from our MPs, our political leaders that we anticipate.
So what kind of response you receive from Canadian government this year?
This year, we had MPs speak at our event virtually, as well as, you know, put out statements supporting and recognizing Tibetan National Uprising Day.
So the Tibetan Coalition in Canada called upon the Canadian government to legislate a bill equivalent to the U.S. Tibetan Policy and Support Act 2020. You also asked the Canadian government to stand by the Dalai Lama and the Tibetan Buddhist community's wishes to be in charge of the Dalai Lama's reincarnation process, and that Chinese officials who interfere in the process should face tough sanctions. What do you get response from current Canadian government?
So, you know, since the 1970s, when Tibetans first immigrated to Canada, we've always had incremental support from the Canadian government. We've had, you know, prime ministers meet the Dalai Lama. We've had, you know, more immigration of Tibetans. We've had, we've had MPs call upon the Chinese government to engage in meaningful dialogue with His Holiness the Dalai Lama's representatives and the Central Tibetan Administration. We've had the creation of Can Special Committee of Canada-China Relations, which allows for, you know, Tibetan activists to speak there and speak with MPs to, you know, engage in meaningful activism for Tibet. However, I want to say that, you know, with all of this in mind, we've had very little movement, nothing as substantial as the Tibetan Policy and Support Act from the US, for example. You know, reciprocal access to Tibet passed in the US in 2018. We have not seen any movement of that in Canada. You know, reciprocal access, for example, calls on Chinese officials that deny American citizens visa to China, that they should not have visa to America. You know, it's on the basis of reciprocity and mutual respect. But that should be the same for Canadians. You know, if Canadian citizens want to visit Tibet, but Chinese officials stop us, that means that they shouldn't be allowed to Canada as well. So that's reciprocal access to Tibet, and that's something that, you know, we've not seen any movement on. And in terms of, you know, the Tibetan Policy and Support Act, that's a big step that the American government has taken, the US government, and we want to see something like that in Canada. Tibetan Canadians deserve that. And it's on the basis of, you know, human rights violations that are happening inside Tibet. It's on the basis of, you know, the Tibetan struggle for the last 62 years. So it's unfair that we don't have those, you know, tools. You know, we're very happy that the Dalai Lama, for example, is a Canadian honorary citizen, an honorary Canadian citizen, and that was in 2006. And he's only the third person to be an honorary Canadian citizen, and that's a very meaningful symbolic gesture. But we want to see more action and, you know, more tougher, you know, stance on China, especially when I feel like it is definitely a, you know, election item for a lot of voters, for example, if that's something that's important to, you know, Canadian politicians. You know, the Conservatives, the NDP, they have all, you know, stood up and called on different measures of support, but the, you know, current administration, the Liberal government, has not. They've stood by on a lot of these, you know, calls to action. So we want to see more of that, especially I think it's high time now that it's been 60 odd years.
This year, you also wanted to see action from Canada on environment protection of the Tibetan Plateau, implementation of reciprocal access to Tibet, establishing a Canadian consulate in Tibet, and acknowledging the role of Central Tibetan Administration. How did Canadian government respond?
So, you know, there are very few countries in the world that recognize the Central Tibetan Administration, and sadly, Canada is not one of them. They have, you know, they don't recognize Central Tibetan Administration as a government in exile, but we do. It is a fair democratic way that we've elected those people to represent us and our interests. So they are, you know, a legitimate group for the Tibetan people, but they are not for the Canadian government. In terms of environment, I think it's important to note that Tibet is considered, you know, the third pole of the world. The river, the water that flows down the Tibetan Plateau, you know, it goes to one third of the world's population, including India. And, you know, with any kinds of implication on that from climate change is one thing, but the other thing is China is, you know, actively building dams to divert waters to, and they're actually causing droughts on downstream countries, many in the Southeast Asia, for example. So they're, you know, using Tibetan water as a way to control and to sort of oppress other countries. The other important thing to note is also that, you know, the nomads, Tibetans, one third of Tibetans inside Tibet are nomads, which means, you know, they sort of graze the land. They have animals. They are the, you know, real keepers of the land of Tibet. You know, the grasslands really contribute to mitigating climate change. You know, the bad things that happen from climate change, right? So the fact that, you know, nomads are being put into these residential houses with nothing around them, that they're being taken off the land so that the Chinese government can use the land for their own purposes, like mining, really, really hurts the environment. And, you know, climate, as you know, is not, you know, is not within just a boundary of political, you know, geographical location. It affects the whole globe. It affects everyone. So Tibet and climate issues in Tibet affects all of us globally. So we have to recognize it and act on it.
So how did Canadian governments in the past help Tibetan Canadians in their struggle for free Tibet?
You know, as I've been saying, unfortunately, there's very little. We recognize that, like the conservative leaders and the NDP leaders, they are speaking out on it, and we appreciate that. But we haven't seen any strong bills. Like, there has been support from individual MPs like Garnet Jennis or Senator Tan Hai Ngo, you know, that bring these bills to the floor or to the Special Committee on Canada-China Relations. And we appreciate those, but we haven't yet seen, a bill pass where we could meaningfully address the Tibetan struggle. And we're hopeful that it'll come soon, and that, you know, we will keep pushing on it, and especially with the support of our allies across, you know, Hong Kong, Uyghur, Chinese Canadians that want democracy in China, the Indian diaspora here. So with all of the support from, you know, our coalitions, we are hopeful that we will see some real movement on Tibet.
So India has always been a front line to help Tibet. So what are your expectations, your group's expectations from Indo-Canadians in terms of seeking their support and help?
Definitely, India has been on the front line for, you know, to support Tibet for many, many decades now. I and both my parents were actually born in India. I was born in Dharamsala, so I know the importance of, you know, for me, for example, if I say I'm going back home, for someone who's never been to Tibet, for me, back home is India. So I definitely recognize, you know, that Tibetans, that Indians have been on the front line, helping Tibetans. But at the same time, I do want to, you know, also shine the light on, you know, the Special Frontier Force, I believe, which has a lot of Tibetans that, you know, fight on the Indian borders. And many Tibetan Jawans have lost their life fighting for India. And I think, you know, these people and the soldiers that are fighting on the front lines are also a metaphor for Tibet itself. You know, Tibet itself is, you know, geographically so significant. The fact that we are, you know, between China and India, the fact that, that we want, I think our security is also India's security. And also I want to recognize that China is surrounding India with their Belt and Road Initiative, right? With Nepal, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, even Burma now, Afghanistan. So they are providing, you know, investments for basic infrastructure, but really, you know, really, changing the political climate there and controlling the political climate there. And so I believe that, you know, Tibetans, with our struggle and our freedom and our independence, also comes a sense of security for India, because it's not just based on political, you know, diplomacy. It's also based on the fact that we have so much shared culture and shared trust, and years and years of friendship. So I think that is really important in having that sort of sense of security for India as well.
So how's Students for a Free Tibet Canada working to create Tibet situation awareness across Canadian campuses?
Well, it's sad to say, but there's many people in the world, many Canadians who still don't know what Tibet is, right? I will walk in the street and I'll say, you know, I'm here from Students for Free Tibet Canada. And they're like, free who? Free what? Right? What is Tibet? So there are some people that are still out there that are like that. And so, what better place than university campuses and college campuses to educate and raise awareness about Tibet? You know, there are young minds that are willing to soak and willing to learn and also have this optimism and a sense of justice. So, you know, college and university campuses are a great place for movements to start, and young people are at the forefront of a lot of movements. The other thing is, you know, college and university campuses also allow for us to really collaborate with different kinds of interest groups and different kinds of people that are also looking to better the world and fight for human rights across, you know, different nations and different territories. So for us, having that kind of coalition and support and networking is also really important, and college and university really, you know, contribute to that.
So how would you like to conclude our discussion in the end?
I think I really wanted to conclude on the note that, you know, Tibetans and Indians, we must, you know, stand in solidarity with each other. You know, we've had students for Free Tibet Canada, many, you know, interns and members that were of Indian origin, Indian Canadians. And, you know, there's that solidarity there that's so important to cultivate and to keep. And you know, I would really like to see more collaboration between our groups and more ways to hold China accountable and to better just the world through, you know, human rights activism.
Thank you very much, Yudhon Samusang. We really appreciate your time, and we hope that we'll be able to take your comments in future as well.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Tahir.
Thank you very much. Thank you for joining us. Viewers, you just heard the views of Yudhon Samusang from Students for a Free Tibet Canada. Thank you for watching Candid Talk with Tahir Gora at TAG TV.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.